This is done because the treatment of head and neck cancers is dependent on the site which is involved. So that is very important to classify the head and neck cancers into the various subsites. So basically, broadly, we divide them into lip and oral cavity cancers, laryngeal cancers, oropharyngeal cancers, and hypopharyngeal cancers. Further subsites, I think you people know better than me, so I'm not going into detail of that. Coming to the incidence breakup of head and neck cancers, so most common head and neck cancers are actually oropharyngeal and oral cavity cancers. Then comes the hypopharyngeal cancers. Coming to the pathology of head and neck cancers, by and large, squamous cell carcinoma is the most common histological type of malignancy in head and neck cancers. More than 95% of the head and neck cancers will be squamous cell carcinoma. Other rare varieties are adenocarcinoma, salivary gland tumors, sinonasal undifferentiated carcinoma, we also call them SNUC, neuroendocrine tumors like esthesioneuroblastoma. Rarely, it could be soft tissue tumors like sarcoma. It could be hematolymphoid malignancies like non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Tumors of bone and cartilage could be seen in head and neck regions. Rarely, metastatic cancers. And recently, there is a new addition called human papillomavirus positive oropharyngeal cancers, HPV positive oropharyngeal cancer. So it's a new entity in the head and neck cancer profile. Going ahead, head and neck cancers have a natural history. So basically, each and every cancer has a particular behavior, and that behavior of that cancer we call as the natural history of that cancer, right? So like every other cancer, head and neck cancers also have a typical behavior. So most of these cancers are known for locoregional spread. So that means that they are known for spread to the local areas, and also they are known for regional spread. So regional spread means spread to the lymph nodal area, the draining lymph nodes corresponding to the site of primary. So as the locoregional spread is common, after the treatment, the recurrences are also most of the times locoregional. So local recurrence and nodal recurrences are common in head and neck cancers. Distant metastasis, whether you talk at the time of presentation of malignancy or at the time of recurrence, is relatively rare, only accounts for 5 to 10%. And second primaries are around 10 to 20%. So by definition, second primaries we also call as field cancerization. So this term basically denotes that a common etiological factor, which is say exposure to tobacco, is the primary cause of head and neck cancer. So that tobacco exposure is also responsible for other cancers like esophageal cancer, gastric cancers. Okay, so field cancerization means common etiological factor leading to multiple cancers. So these patients, sometimes laryngeal cancer patient or an oral cavity cancer patients, can have concomitant or synchronous second primary. So that is why it is important, as we were discussing in the case discussion, it was very interesting case. So we need to keep that in mind that there is a possibility of synchronous second primaries, which should be ruled out by whatever imaging. It could be an endoscopy or a CT scan or a PET scan, as one of the senior faculty mentioned. So coming to the management of head and neck cancers. So basically, management of head and neck cancers requires a multi-modality team approach. Okay. So it's a team approach. Multiple specialties are involved in the management of head and neck cancers, like a surgical oncologist, preferably a head and neck surgeon, radiation oncologist, medical oncologist, medical physicist. Medical physicists are basically people who are in the back end. They support us for doing the radiation planning. Then radiotherapy technologist, dentistry and prosthodontic specialist, speech and swallowing therapy. Speech and swallowing therapy mainly for post-treatment rehabilitation. Coming to the general management guidelines of head and neck cancers. So the basic aim of managing a head and neck cancer is to achieve highest locoregional control. So basically, this is corresponding to the natural history of cancer, right? Some cancers, they will have a natural history of spread to other organs like lung cancer. So they are known for distant metastasis. So there, the primary aim is to have local control and also to have a distant control. But here, because head and neck cancer distant mets are not very common, our primary aim is to have a highest locoregional control. And that is why we were discussing surgery or chemoradiation. So because all these are locoregional therapies. Anatomical and functional preservation is also of paramount importance because quality of life after the treatment also matters for the patient. Broadly speaking, stage 1 and 2 head and neck cancers, single modality of treatment is sufficient, like either surgery or radiation. stage 3 and 4 head and neck cancers, usually combined modality therapy is required, which could be primary surgery followed by adjuvant treatment in the form of radiation, or it could be radiation and chemotherapy combined. Now, it depends upon the site what we are talking about. So, yes, so this is very important slide. So, which basically guides us about how should we approach the patient primarily with the treatment based on the sub-site. So, malignancies on the left side of this slide, surgery is the primary treatment. So, paranasal sinus, cancers of paranasal sinuses, nasal cavity tumors, oral cavity tumors, salivary gland tumors, and thyroid. So, these malignancies, the primary treatment should be first surgery. Post-surgery, depending upon the histopathological features, we see some high-risk pathological features. That is also a very important postgraduate question. Examiners might ask you, after surgery, what are the typical things which you are going to see to decide whether this patient is at high risk for relapse? So basically, adjuvant therapy is required for patients who are at high risk for relapse, loco-regional relapse. Now, how do you say this patient deserves adjuvant treatment based on the high-risk factors? So you have to study the histopathological report in detail. You should see the margin status, whether it is positive or close. Close margin means anything less than 5 mm in head and neck cancer is considered as close margin. You should look for lymph nodal involvement. You should look for lymphovascular space invasion, LVSI. You should look for perineural invasion, PNI. Then you should look for grade. Grade is also very important. High-grade malignancies, they have high risk for local recurrence. Okay. Now, malignancies on the right-hand side, usually radiation alone or combined with chemotherapy is the treatment of choice. So, like nasopharyngeal malignancies, oropharyngeal malignancies, larynx and hypopharynx, provided there is no cartilage invasion. Once the cartilage is involved, usually surgery becomes the first line of therapy. But when the cartilage is free, you can give a chance to the patient to have an organ preservation in the form of chemoradiation. Okay. Now I am coming to the radiation techniques from basics to advanced. So this here you are seeing basically a diagram showing a case of head and neck cancer with lymph nodal metastasis. So in the olden times, we had cobalt 60 machine only, and we never had the luxury to do three-dimensional volumetric imaging of the patient and then planning. So what we used to do is we only had a conventional simulator, which is just like an X-ray. X-ray where the X-ray source can be rotated like a C-arm, like a C-arm. So what we used to do is we used to acquire an X-ray of head and neck lesion in the lateral position. Then we used to mark on the skin, design our portal based on the bony landmarks. So basically, in the past, it's called two-dimensional radiotherapy planning. So this has become actually now the thing of the past. I'll tell you why. So we used to plan radiation based on the bony landmarks, depending. So and those bony landmarks used to depend upon what site we are treating. If it is a nasopharynx, your upper border is going to be. It should include the base of the skull with a 1 cm margin. If it is a tonsil, you should go up to zygomatic process like that. So that's how we used to mug up the margins of the radiation portals based on the site. But the problem with these techniques is that they are not highly precise radiation planning techniques. Because what happens is, if you see this is a case of carcinoma of the right lateral pharyngeal wall, and the colored area what you are seeing on this diagram is actually the radiation dose distribution. So as the tumor focus is here, but we end up treating the entire area from right to left. So basically, this plan is radiation is delivered from the right lateral portal and left lateral portal. So anything which comes in between those two portals gets full dose of radiation. Okay. So what happens is this. So there will be acute skin reactions in the form of desquamation, ulceration, necrosis. There will be acute mucosal reactions, xerostomia on the longer run, because we could not spare the parotid glands in those days. And all these things leads to basically poor compliance. We cannot escalate the dose for better tumor control because patient is not tolerating the treatment well, and also the poor prognosis. So basically, the outcomes used to be not that great with those conventional techniques. So then came into existence high precision radiation. So what people did is they redefined the machines in such a way that we could focus the radiation dose to the affected area with, of course, a safety margin, depending upon the microscopic possible microscopic spread of the disease. And that technology gave us the capacity to spare the normal structures at the same time. So what happens is, so there are less side effects because we are able to spare the normal surrounding tissue. There's a better tolerability, there's a better compliance, better coverage of the tumor. So deep-seated tumor, sometimes with those two-dimensional techniques, we will not be able to cover the tumor adequately. Like part of the tumor may get full dose, part of the tumor may get underdose. But here with these techniques, we actually visualize how much tumor is getting, how much the surrounding organs are getting the dose. So that is the benefit. And with that benefit, we are able to confidently escalate the dose, because now we are confident that we are able to spare the normal tissue. We have some confidence to increase the dose so as to achieve a better tumor control. And of course, with less side effects, you will have better prognosis. Now, this slide basically tells you that what is basically the difference between high precision radiation and ordinary radiation. So this is an ordinary two-dimensional radiotherapy planning. You see, the parotids, all entire 100% of the parotid gland is there in the field of radiation. So this patient is definitely going to have xerostomia, severe xerostomia. Part of the oral cavity is in the field of radiation. Spinal cord is in the field of radiation. So spinal cord has a tolerance of around 44 to 45 Gray. After delivering that much of dose, you will not be able to treat any lymph node in this area. Okay, so you have to spare the spinal cord, because spinal cord is a very important organ. You cannot afford to have a patient who has a spinal cord myelopathy secondary to radiation. So what happens is, you will end up underdosing the lymph node area in these areas, in the posterior cervical area. So, but here if you see, this is an IMRT plant. In this, we are able to nicely, so this colored area is the dose distribution. We are able to spare the spinal cord nicely, we are able to spare the oral cavity and parotids. So we can deliver a tumoricidal dose, that means a radiation dose which can kill the tumor cell, and at the same time, we are able to spare the normal structure. So that is the beauty of high precision radiation therapy techniques. And this technique is called IMRT, intensity modulated radiotherapy. There's another technique called RapidArc, which I'll show you in the next slide. So this is an IMRT plan of a case of aesthetic neuroblastoma. So now the location of this tumor is so critical that it is close to optic apparatus, it is close to retina, chiasma, brainstem. With ordinary techniques of radiation, it is very challenging to treat such patients. So with this technique of intensity modulated radiotherapy, so you can see here, it utilizes multiple portals. So basically, there we were just using one right lateral and one left lateral portal. But here, we put beams from multiple angles and we try to modulate the beam in such a way that the dose distribution is such that we are able to spare the normal nearby structures and we are able to deliver the tumoricidal dose to the target area. Coming to the RapidArc technique. So IMRT is intensity modulated radiotherapy, which was the one step ahead of the basic 2D and 3D techniques. RapidArc is one step ahead of intensity modulated radiotherapy. So here what happens is, it basically improvises the normal tissue sparing over IMRT. So IMRT spares normal structures well, but RapidArc spares the normal tissue even better than IMRT. It utilizes an arc-based radiation therapy. So as you can see here, it's a continuous arc. It continues to deliver radiation in an arc fashion and at the same time modulates the intensity of the beam such that we get a dose distribution better than IMRT. Another thing is, it delivers radiation 8 to 10 times faster than IMRT. So a typical head and neck cancer case would actually require around 20 to 25 minutes for one session of radiation per day. Okay, and the same quality or even the better quality of radiotherapy delivery can be achieved with RapidArc with almost 8 to 10 times faster treatment delivery. So 25 minutes treatment by IMRT can be delivered in around 3 to 4 minutes with RapidArc technique. So this basically improves the throughput of a department. You can treat more patients if you have this technology. So this slide basically compares IMRT and RapidArc. On the left hand side, you see the IMRT dose distribution. So spinal cord, of course, we are able to spare here. So this blue area is actually the low dose area. Okay, and this green is high, red is the highest doses. Okay, so here we are able to spare the spinal cord, but still some low dose spillage is there in the spinal cord area. Whereas in RapidArc, we are able to spare the spinal cord better than IMRT. So this is again showing slide showing the dose spillage. So now I will show you few cases and close my talk. So this is the same case, aesthetic neuroblastoma. You can see the growth involving the roof of the nasal cavity. And this was the dose distribution we could achieve with the IMRT beam arrangement. And here you see the sparing of the orbit. So beautiful sparing of the orbit we could achieve with IMRT, which was just not possible with two-dimensional radiotherapy techniques. And there we could spare the optic chiasma and the optic nerve apparatus. So this was a case of hypopharyngeal cancer treated with radiation, and here you can see the nice sparing of the oral cavity and the spinal cord. Same hypopharyngeal case, sparing of the parotids. So this is the post-radiation last day of radiation photo, clinical photograph. So compare this with the clinical photographs which I showed you showing the skin reactions. So this is acceptable skin reactions for a case of head and neck cancer, and this is the photograph after 1 month follow-up. So they recover well. The mild skin reaction, they recover in a span of 4 to 6 weeks. This is a case of carcinoma of the uvula involving adjacent part of the soft palate. We treated this patient with, it was a squamous cell carcinoma, well differentiated, and we treated this patient with definitive radiotherapy with rapid arc technique, and this was the dose distribution. See, nicely we could spare the nearby critical organs. This was the dose distribution, and 3 months follow-up, we had a complete response. This was a case of inoperable buccal mucosa cancer. So mind you, buccal mucosa cancer surgery is the primary modality of treatment, but there will be clinical scenarios in our practice where the case would be considered inoperable because of multiple factors. It could be tumor-related factors, it could be patient-related factors. Okay. So this was considered inoperable because the growth was fixed and he had a very big lymph node which was fixed to the underlying structure. So he was sent to us for definitive chemoradiation. So this is the clinical picture of the growth, and this is the CT scan, this is the PET component, and this is the PET CT, a fusion of the PET and CT, which shows metabolically active growth involving buccal mucosa with a large lymph nodal involvement. This patient was treated with radiation and concurrent chemotherapy because it was locally advanced, and this is the dose distribution. So another good quality of planning with IMRT and rapid arc is that, see, there will be few areas in head and neck region where we need to deliver a boost dose of radiation because the gross amount of tumor cells are accumulated in those areas, right? So that area deserves higher, relatively higher dose, whereas the areas where we suspect that there will be microscopic spread of the disease, those areas do not require a very high dose of radiation. So here, so this is called dose painting. So basically what we are doing is, in the same sitting, we are able to deliver a relatively higher dose to the gross disease, and at the same time, a relatively lesser dose to the areas where potentially there could be a microscopic spread of the disease. So these green areas are relatively low doses, and these red areas are very high doses, around 66 to 70 gray we deliver. Okay. So, and this is the follow-up PET scan at 3 months. Usually, to do a repeat assessment for tumor response, we should wait for 2.5 to 3 months. Scans should not be done immediately after the therapy. You should give some time for the tumor to respond. And that's the clinical photograph and the PET CT, which showed really good response. This was an interesting case of pyriform malignancy with truncated pre-treated lymph node. This lady was around 35-year-old, and she was sent to us for palliative radiation because surgeon said not worth operating. She weighed just 35 kilograms. So we actually explained the poor prognosis because most of these patients do not do well. Somehow she was lucky enough. This was a PET CT finding. You can see this bright yellow area is the growth, and that's a truncating component of the node. This was treated with definitive radiation and chemotherapy. And this was the clinical photograph on the last day of radiation, brisk skin reactions. And you see significant shrinkage of the growth. So another thing for PG students is sometimes examiner might ask for response, exophytic growth versus an endophytic growth, an infiltrative growth or an ulcerative growth. Will there be any difference in the response to the treatment, especially pertaining to radiation therapy response? So most of the times, exophytic growth will have very good response compared to the infiltrative type of growth. Because infiltrative type of growth will have a hypoxia. The oxygen supply will be poor, so there will be a hypoxia. And hypoxia basically confers radioresistance to the tumors. Okay. Exophytic growth will have a good blood supply, so there will, so oxygenation will be better. So better the oxygenation, better will be the response to the treatment. So this was PET scan after 3 months, which showed good debulking, not a complete response, but there was a significant debulking. And this was 9 months CT scan showing no evidence of disease. So she was lucky enough to have gotten rid of the extensive disease she had. This was a 54-year-old female case of carcinoma of the post-cricoid area. That's a PET CT showing the metabolically active growth. only post required, treated with radiation and concurrent chemotherapy. So the area which had gross involvement of disease had a relatively higher dose compared to the relatively lower dose to the surrounding regional nodal region. And this was the PET scan at 3 months showing complete response. This was an interesting case, elderly man with a ulcerative bleeding growth. Now on biopsy, it came as a basal cell carcinoma. Basal cell carcinoma, one important thing is this cancer also is known for not having nodal metastasis. I heard that in the discussion, there was a discussion about pathologies having less risk of or no risk of nodal metastasis. So basal cell carcinomas usually will not have nodal metastasis. So this was treated with electron beam therapy. Usually electrons we use to treat superficial targets. So basically it's a skin malignancy. So treated with electrons, and this was post treatment, excellent response. Now coming to side effects, every therapy has got some or the other side effects, right? So even radiation and chemotherapy also is not free of side effects. So most common side effects, we basically divide them into acute or late. Acute means during the course of radiation, they can have mucositis, fungal infection, skin hyperpigmentation, poor oral diet because of the mucositis, dysphagia, and leading to weight loss. So basically the management is conservative. Usually we ask them to use oral gargles, topical steroids to relieve mucositis, anti-inflammatory drugs can be prescribed, antifungal agents are a must for head and neck cancers during radiotherapy. Sometimes they may require a feeding tube placement if the nutrition status is going to be poor. And nutrition supplements are really important for such. Late radiation reactions, xerostomia is common if the parotids are not adequately spared. TM joint fibrosis can happen if the temporomandibular joint sparing has not been done during the nutrition planning. Osteo-radio necrosis of the mandible. So this is an interesting late side effect. Earlier days when we used to use cobalt-60 or orthovoltage, low energy X-ray therapy for cancers, this was very common because bone absorbs more radiation dose for ortho voltage X-rays, but these days we are using mega voltage X-rays, MV imaging. So this cobalt 60 machine and linear accelerator. So basically, the machine we use for radiotherapy is called a linear accelerator. It uses mega voltage X-rays. So mega voltage X-rays, bone will absorb the same dose as the soft tissue absorbs. So there is no preferential more absorbance of the dose by the bone. But in olden time radiation, ortho voltage X-rays, bone used to absorb more dose. So those days, radio necrosis of the mandible was common, but these days we rarely see. Now coming to spinal cord myelopathy is a rare effect of radiation if cord was not spared properly during radiation planning, and they are managed with symptomatic medications like artificial saliva for xerostomia, pilocarpine can be tried, regular jaw exercise for TN joint fibrosis. For osteoradio necrosis of the mandible, it can be managed with conservative like hyperbaric oxygen, or they may require surgical intervention like mandibulectomy. Steroids, treatment of choice for spinal cord myelopathy. Now, I'll end my presentation with, I think, last two sliders. So, prognosis of head and neck cancer. So, in cancer, we usually talk about 5-year survival rates. Okay. So, in head and neck cancers, there are few sites which have good response rates. There are few subsites which have bad response rates. Okay. So, it depends upon the site what we are treating, and of course, the stage also is important. So, basically, lip, oral cavity, tongue, nasopharynx, they have good response to whatever treatment, surgery or chemo radiation. So that you see varies from around 60 to 90%, whereas the poor responders are hypopharyngeal cancers like piriform fossa, post required posterior pharyngeal wall, 3 P's. These are the head and neck cancers with poor outcomes with definitive chemo radiation approach. Okay, so probably tumor hypoxia, there could be multiple biological factors, but tumor hypoxia is one of the biological factors why these people are less responsive. Now, the last slide, HPV. So, HPV, oropharyngeal cancers, is a new entity. Basically, they have a distinct epidemiology, clinical and molecular features. Multiple sexual partners basically is a high risk factor for developing HPV related oropharyngeal cancers. P16 expression by IHC. It could be a PG examination question. How would you differentiate HPV associated oropharyngeal cancer versus non-HPV? So P16 is the diagnostic test by IHC, or you can do a polymerase chain reaction PCR on the biopsy specimen, which might suggest a HPV association. These cancers usually present with small primaries and large nodes. small primaries, large nodes, oropharyngeal site, young age, it could be a HPV associated malignancy. There is a lower rate of distant metastasis. These good thing is these tumors are more sensitive to chemoradiation and they have a better survival rate, as you can see there. 95% versus 62% 2-year survival rate for HPV associated cancer. So with this, I will conclude my presentation. Head and neck cancers are prevalent in India. There is a strong association with tobacco. They are known for local regional spread. With better radiation techniques, the survival is improved, cure rates are better, lesser side effects with these advanced radiation therapy techniques. The primary aim of therapy is to have highest local regional control and also at the same time functional and organ preservation. And they need multimodality team approach. Thank you. Thank you, sir. So this is basically the linear accelerator.